everyone, and welcome once again to another program of Prime Time. I'm your host, Beverly. Well, we have some special people with us today, and we're doing a wonderful Zoom chat, and we'll be talking about food. Yes, and it's very special. I have to boast that she's a past student, and she's running her own business along with her husband. They're both owners of a special cooking school, and so we'll chat about that today. And what's happening behind the scenes in the kitchen, and what's happening behind the bar with our mixologist. So stick around, and we'll be right back for this Prime Time.
The innovative Bancomatico contactless smart card. Your Bancomatico smart card is now equipped with a contactless feature for payments. So get ready to tap and go. Contactless payments are fast, easy, secure, and accepted worldwide at all Maestro-enabled contactless terminals. Tap for transactions equivalent to or less than 100 NAF or the U.S. dollar equivalent. You will receive notifications via email anytime you tap. Tap, tap, and pay fast, fast with WIB. For more information, visit our website at wib-bank.net. Tap and go with your partner in progress.
At Travel Planners, we love what we do. Every day, we help our clients plan their vacations, from honeymoons to family reunions, trade shows to conventions, school trips to sports tournaments. Our agents at Travel Planners can help you make better, wiser decisions on travel destinations and cruises and find you the lowest fares. Make some memories with help from Travel Planners in Phillipsburg and on the Airport Road, Simpson Bay. Visit our website at Planners SXM and like us on Facebook at St. Martin Travel Planners. We take care of all your travel needs.
Welcome back. Thank you very much for joining us. This is our first segment. And today we are speaking to Kristian Joseph and Paul Peterson. And that's a couple. They have this new business, not really new, this new idea for business. It's actually, the concept is a cooking school, and it's called Flavor Academy, and it's the new hot thing on St. Martin for dining as well. So welcome, Kristian and Paul, to the program.
Thank you for having us.
Happy to be on your show today.
Nice to have you. Well, Paul, we all know you. You're the famous guy who's done all these competitions and done all these mixologists traveling all over for all these competitions, and it's nice to see you, that you and Kristian, as a married couple, have your own business now, and it's called the Flavor Academy. So Kristian, tell me, I know that you went to St. Dominic Primary and the high school, and then you went away to study. What made you decide to study to be a chef?
Well, originally it wasn't my first thought of what I was going to be when I grew up. So I ended up in Canada studying environmental sciences. And for whatever reason, I just couldn't, I wasn't happy in school.
You wasn't wrapping your head around it.
Yeah, I was passing my classes and everything, but I just wasn't passionate about it. And I realized that I don't want to be in a field that is behind a desk or not actively doing something creative. So I started to think about all the things I loved. And one of the things I loved was cooking. And I said, well, you know, maybe it's something I could pursue. So I dropped out of university, came back to the island for a year to do some training. Because to apply to culinary school, you needed to do like job training to have some experience. That's when I met Paul.
And the mixologist.
Yes.
Yeah.
We worked together briefly at Temptation. And Cooker Boy back in the day. And then I went to culinary school, and the rest is history, essentially. It just was something I loved and I had a passion for. And I liked that kind of like adrenaline rush of working, you know, under pressure, being creative. So, yeah.
I'm curious if you used to help your mom in the kitchen as a young person growing up.
Yes, always. I was always in the kitchen. I was obsessed with not only eating food, but trying to figure out how to make food. And with my grandmother, especially, every time I was with her, I would be the one of the few grandchildren in the kitchen with her, behind her like a shadow. With my dad, I always had a passion for being in the kitchen. I used to wake up early in the mornings before school and watch Great Chefs of the World and see the different chefs featured, like, since I was in second grade, you know. It was just something I always loved.
And so so let's see now that how the concept of Flavor Academy, the cooking school. So, Paul, what were you all chatting about to get this off the ground?
COVID was something that kind of shaped a little bit of what the business is today. We started with a slightly different concept, and because of lockdown and everything, we kind of changed a little bit. Not completely, just a little bit over, you know, those traumatic times of lockdown. And right now we focus a little bit more on giving a more of a private or just a small group service to a small group, or, you know, so it's very personal. It's you know, we give our heart and soul into the whole project. So it's it's something that we hope that people will see and taste the love that we put into it.
So go ahead, Kristian.
I think it kind of also came about too, because when we traveled, every time we travel, I used to love to take a cooking class in whatever country we were in. And it was just something fun to do that was a little bit different, that we get the element of learning about the culture that you're with, like the country that you're visiting in through their food. So originally before COVID, a lot of it was targeted towards the idea of teaching Caribbean food to tourists. And then obviously with Corona, we kind of readapted the strategy to just make it more for everybody and to learn any kind of cuisine. So it kind of, like as Paul said, just kind of adapted and grew into something a little bit different than we originally conceived it to be.
Right. So let's look. This is the time that we're in, and we all have to adjust. So what is happening at Flavor Academy? How much teaching and how many private dinners are you hosting?
So I would say we're doing a good even mix of both. We do a lot of private classes with people, just like small groups of friends that want to book for especially birthdays and special occasions. It's like a nice excuse to get together, and you don't have to do the dishes. You have fun together, enjoy some cocktails. So I'd say it's about 50-50, because we also offer, as I said, like a private chef experience where essentially I act as a private chef catering for you that special evening, and Paul acts as the host and takes care of, you know, all the mixology and all of the service. So I would say it's about 50-50 at this current point in time.
And so Paul, when someone, for example, not a teaching one, but when someone wants to have a function at Flavor Academy, what kind of drinks in the alcoholic area, what are they requesting?
Well, we have a very nice craft cocktail menu put together. And we also have a pretty good wine list as well, but most people just go for cocktails when they're here. But
they know it because they know you.
Yeah, so yeah, cocktails are pretty popular here. So we have a really nice selection of most of the cocktails that I've used in past competitions. On our list, so they're you know, tried and true cocktails that people really like, and we have a nice selection of alcohols too, so some really good rums and whiskeys, gins.
How do you keep up, Paul, as to what's happening out there? Because you know the drinks and cocktails are evolving every day.
I visit all the whatever cocktail bars pop up on the island. I'm always the first one to go and check them out.
And so, Kristian, what's your before we get into the kitchen, we'll do that in the next segment. Do you like cocktails, wines, rums, or whiskey?
I'm a wine drinker for sure, but Paul does make a good cocktail that even I can enjoy. Somebody who doesn't like cocktails, I will say, maybe I'm biased, but he does make a good cocktail. But definitely, I'm a wine girl.
You're a winer. Yeah. Okay, we take a break, and then when we come back, we'll talk a little bit about your travels, because I know in your course of study, You went to California and did some internship there and so on. So we'll chat a little bit about that. And sure. And much more. This is Prime Time, and we're speaking to Kristian and Paul, and they are the owners of a cooking school, and it's entitled Flavor Academy. And I will also share my experiences at Flavor Academy in the next segment. So stick around, and we'll be right back. This is Prime Time.
This is Rupert Brown, better known in the community as Major Brown. Because of my service in the police, I've been with NAGICO for the past 30-something years. I think it's around 35. And I've always been satisfied with the service I got with them. They have helped many people in this island. As long as I have to keep on insuring them with any company, I will choose Najico.
Every time I go to Najico, I get the best service that I needed.
I think it took a little longer to be paid off, but I could understand they had to bring in the people out from outside. The damage was so great that they needed people from outside to make the assessments, and that took a little longer. But in the end, I was satisfied that I had people in Najico who you consider friends. And that's why I've remained with Najico all these years, because of the friendliness of the people in there.
Choose strength. Choose reliability. Choose Najico Insurances.
A cruise is a great adventure. Not only for passengers, also for us. The Port of St. Martin. Our port always reflected the needs and aspirations of the time. From the first to the 1.75 millionth passenger in 2013. Our cruise story started in 1963 with our first cruise passenger. 50 great years later. 20 million passengers later. Thousands of cruise berths later. We've become the leading port in the Caribbean. 50 fantastic years. Like a dream. The dream of Port St. Martin lives on and reinvents itself every day. The best is yet to come.
Welcome back, and thank you very much for joining us. This is Prime Time, and today, yeah, we're having a wonderful chat with Kristian and Paul, and they are the owners of the Cooking School Flavor Academy. Now, I'm going to be biased myself, Kristian, and I can see that if you're interested, you can go to visit them. They're in, is that Simpson Bay? What do you call that area, Kristian?
Technically, I think it's Simpson Bay, yes.
In Simpson Bay, where Dr. Colley's office is, downstairs there. And that room is wonderful. So, Kristian, tell me a little bit about the dynamics of that. Someone wants to do a private party for a wedding anniversary.
So we offer currently two different services. One would be cooking classes, which is for a smaller group of about 4 to 6, sometimes 8, depending on what the lesson is and if I think that it's a group size that's manageable, depending on the subject matter. Or we also offer like a private dinner experience. And the best way to go about it is to just contact us through our Facebook page. And from there, I always discuss menu with our guests if there's any dietary restrictions or anything to note, any allergies. And we try to build a custom menu around, you know, any information we have of our guests so that everybody's satisfied. But we do one menu for the entire group, unless somebody's a vegetarian or something, then we make exceptions or what's the word for it? Like
alternatives.
Yeah, alternatives for any dietary restrictions amongst our guests. And then from there, we just approve the menu, go back and forth until everybody's satisfied. And then, yeah, you just, once you have your dates booked, which is sometimes the hardest part, is getting a spot, because it's just one table an evening. So, you know, days go quickly. We can't accommodate different groups at one time. So sometimes availability is limited. So once you have your dates and we discuss menu, that's it. You show up and you have hopefully a good experience.
So I have a party for 12 persons, and I came to you. How soon, because I get the impression that you're doing all the cooking. How long does that take? When do you start prepping?
Well, I wake up in the morning. I start doing like little...
It's a 12-hour day.
Yeah, office work, answering people, stuff like that. And then about 1 o'clock, hopefully I'm in the grocery store or going to different suppliers to get all of the produce and supplies for the evening. And usually I'm in the kitchen at about 2 to 3. Hopefully it's nice when I get there too, to be ready for 7:30. So I would say about 5 hours of prep. And then from then on into the night.
So Paul, tell us how you all had to adjust. Because I know that because of COVID restriction, social distancing, masking, and so on. How have you all overcome that hurdle?
It was pretty easy, actually, because initially we were thinking of having the place open to just anybody can come in. And, you know, there would be different people mingling with each other. But then the COVID thing happened and we realized that maybe we should just look at doing private events, whereas small groups can come in and only, you know, only the people that they're with would be, you know, come up to the restaurant. And that has been like, you know, the thing that everybody wants to do, especially in the times that we live in right now. So yeah, it's been an easy transition from the original plan to actually what we do now with the private events.
I know the room is closing. So are you now asking people to be vaccinated? Are you asking people to keep their mask on? What's the protocol for that?
Well, we have sanitation stations all over, and you know, just like every other restaurant that's out there, they do the same thing. You know, they have the little notice at the door. Have sanitizer stations all over. We're vaccinated, but we also wear a mask all the time throughout the entire service. We don't ask the guests to, because they're, you know, we want them to be comfortable, but for our safety and for theirs, we wear masks. There are a few guests that actually ask us to not wear masks, because some people are a bit more, you know, open with the whole idea, but we 100% of the time we wear a mask unless, you know, the guest asks us not.
Tell us about your start in California and the Napa Valley.
So I went to culinary school at the Culinary Institute of America in St. Helena, which is a small little town in Napa Valley. And yeah, it was a 2-year program. It was very intensive, you know, going over all of the culinary education with a little hint of management and different aspects besides just cooking. And it was the two most wonderful years of my life was that school experience. On the weekends, we would go and wine taste because we were there in the most, you know, perfect setting. And it was very interesting to do my studies in California because they were very, with a lot of emphasis on farm to table movement and sustainability, which I think is quite a good concept to have a lot of plant-based kind of restaurants and things like that, which was very good exposure and brought a lot of awareness to that aspect of cooking, like not wasting and trying to use as much local as you can.
How challenging is that from farm to table to do that in St. Martin?
It is a little bit more challenging, but it's definitely not impossible. Even farm-to-table restaurants in like the States, for example, still do end up buying certain produce items that, you know, maybe like carrots and onions, maybe not, but, you know, certain staples. It is definitely more challenging here because there isn't the same amount of farming happening, but it is possible. And we try as much as we can to use local eggs, local vegetables. We get our microgreens from a lovely guy who supplies it to us and grows it just for us. So we try as much as we can to use community products, like local products, where we can. And of course, when, you know, certain things are not in season or available locally, we use imported products, of course. But as we try our best to keep them organic and, you know, fresh, sustainable kind of concept, using local fish, local seafood, local eggs, vegetables, produce.
So Paul, tell us how you got involved in being a mixologist, and how did you get so good? Because to me, every time you traveled, you came back with the first prize.
Well, I started working. hard work, I guess. I started working in restaurants since I was 17. I was still in school, and I started to work in restaurants, and I just kind of, it became my career over the years. And in 2006, there was a competition for Taste of the Caribbean, and by chance, actually, there was somebody else that already had the place to go to be the representative for St. Martin. But they had some kind of visa issue or something along those lines. And then they asked me if I would fill in, and I did. And I went and I won the entire competition. And then the next year we went again and I won it again. And it just pretty much snowballed from there on. And, you know, my mixologist career was born out of that.
Yeah. So, but we're going to take a break. And when we come back, I want to ask you, what do you think is the secret that made your drinks, yeah, always come on top? Because, you know, what, it has to be a little something that separated you from the pack. Yeah? So you stick around and we'll be right back. This is Prime Time. You can view this program and all of the programs on Facebook and on YouTube as well. And don't forget to subscribe. We'll be back in a moment.
The Daily Herald is my first source for up-to-date information and news. Putting together this program of Prime Time requires research and knowledge of current events. For local news, regional and international news, do read the Daily Herald.
And so in our final segment, Paul, I don't really want to put you on the spot, but I really want to know what you think it is that sets you apart from the pack. Because these competitions are very tight. They everybody wants to win. Everybody thinks that their cocktail tastes the best. So what was it you think that made you keep winning all that time? What was your secret ingredient? I know it's a secret.
It's not much of a secret, really. I grew up, here, and I grew up eating local fruit, and I remember eating kinnips and pomcerettes, sea grapes. All of these things are things that I remember so much as a kid. So when these competitions come about, and especially if it's a competition based on Caribbean ingredients and Caribbean flavors, it's something that I've grew up with and I love, So I always try to incorporate that in my drinks, as much as there's so much great ingredients in the world, I'm very partial to my Caribbean fruits and Caribbean ingredients. And I always try to incorporate a little bit of that into a cocktail, especially because if a tourist is coming to our island to enjoy the cocktail, they want to enjoy our flavors. And I guess that's a little bit of what goes into my thought when it comes to creating a cocktail.
So all the thousands of cocktails you've made, which is your favorite?
Oh, God.
Is it one made with pineapple, with strawberries? Is it with five fingers?
I'm a purist. I like a good rum. And if it's a good rum, I'll drink it just like that. Really.
But what is your favorite cocktail you've made? Like, if you have to pick one cocktail you've made.
Oh, that's tough.
I will answer
that. That's like asking, which is your favorite kid?
It's like I'll asking. Which is your favorite, right?
That's my favorite one.
I wasn't here to you, Paul.
I think one of his best ones is the fig and rum sour. So it's made with like fig jam and nice rum. It's very simple, but the combination is perfect. And the texture of the little fig seeds at the end is exquisite. So I'll answer that now.
So I must ask you, so what's next? Because you seem to be having a good time with Flavor Academy, doing the teachings and also accommodating people who want private dinners and so on. But what's next? What do you want to do next?
Well, I think we're so much focused on the present right now that we're not even... It might not sound right to say this, like we're not thinking about the future, but we're so focused and so like in the present right now and enjoying what we do and putting our heart and soul into what we do right now that the present is more important for us, I guess, than looking, ahead a year or 2 years or 3 years or 4 years from now. I think right now is more important than what's in the
future. So Kristian, are you getting tourists coming in and asking for classes as yet? Because we started and seems to be pretty busy.
Yeah, and not fully as yet. I think we have to do a little bit of advertising. For that, we haven't advertised as yet because we've been working based on word of mouth and a lot to do with just local clientele mainly. All of our clientele is local, which we're very grateful for. And we've been really focusing on that clientele. But we're hoping also by word of mouth and through Facebook and stuff like that to reach the tourist sector. But for us, our pride and joy is our local guests. And like our local customers, because they are very loyal and they make up 100% of our business. So that's what we've been focusing so far. But if tourists wanted to come, I would be more than happy as well.
So Kristian, when you're not cooking and when Paul is not mixing, what do you all do for relaxation and fun?
I garden. I have plants, I grow them, I talk to my little babies. And Paul is a builder, so he builds me shelves for my plants, tables, chairs. He's really into like building and...
Yeah, I think if I wasn't a bartender, I'd be a carpenter. There you go. That's my second favorite.
So Paul, you good at it?
I've improved a lot. Yeah, I have. In the beginning, I was a little scared, like, you know, of a power saw and those kind of things. But now I've gotten very good at what I do.
So not only does he look like Jesus. Oh, sorry. He doesn't only look like Jesus. Now he's a carpenter too.
Yeah, right, exactly. But anyway, it's a good footstep to follow. So Paul, you also doing some teaching during the day?
Yeah, I work full-time at NIPA, at the National Institute for Professional Advancement, because I always got to say that, because when I say NIPA, people are like, where? And I teach in the hospitality sector at NIPA. I teach a few different subjects there: food safety, table service, customer service.
Are you teaching them to mix drinks? Or you keep that secret to yourself?
Yeah, no. I teach the students there as well. That's a lot of my pride comes from, you know, being at that at school and being able to give back a little, you know, a little bit of my knowledge to other people as well that can, you know, benefit.
Are the students focused and interested?
Most of them are. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. This is wonderful. Yeah, I had an experience at Slave Academy late last year. And it was out of this world, the excellence of the food and the taste and the service and the attention to detail. And it's a wonderful, wonderful restaurant. And so if you're thinking of doing something special and out of the ordinary, Flavor Academy is the place for you. By the way, before we leave, who designed the restaurant?
I did.
Yes. You did. So you did a lot of, because you have a lot of little nice pieces that I know you researched and looked up and gathered up.
Yeah, we did it over quarantine. So interior decorating became another hobby during quarantine.
All right, Paul and Kristian, thank you so much for joining us on the program, and we wish you all success. And
Thank you.
This is his time time. Thank you so much for watching, as we are committed to bringing you excellent programs. This was another highlight of our personality profile. Two young people, taking a big step and having their own business, the restaurant business and cooking school. So this is it for Prime Time today. See you next week, and may God bless.